Hello and welcome to Rantzerker number 8. We're better feminists than you. Today we'll be discussing the article 9 Things That Really Do Make You a Better Feminist Than Everyone Else by Megan Murphy, which appeared on The Feminist Current on September 11th, 2015. And the person who will be playing the part of Megan Murphy is none other than our very lovely Dr. Randomer Cam.
Hello.
Let's give him a big hand.
Woo. Yay. It's a very exciting, yes. moment.
I thought I'd do it in my best supercilious purple mole voice.
It's a lovely purple mole voice. Okay, so why don't you take it away, Dr. Randomer Cam, and start with the first wonderful paragraph of this... Wonderful.
Okay, so that's the first bullet point, would that be?
Oh, no, let's do the beginning. We can have a discussion on
very
what
well,
it...
Very well,
the entire preamble.
Okay. Why read Bustle, you might ask? Well, naturally, for hilarious listicles like one published yesterday, titled 9 Things That Don't Make You a Better Feminist Than Everybody Else, I'll save you a few minutes better wasted staring at your paws or Instagramming your cat and summarize it for you. Everything you do is feminist. And everyone is a feminist, and also feminism is whatever you say it is. Hashtag blasted. Feel better? Oh good, perfect. I'm looking forward to the next listicle. 11 things that don't make Marx a better communist than you. Do you own the means of production? So what? Don't let anyone gatekeep your communism. Hashtag communism is for everyone. I don't know what that says.
I think it says born bougie. I think that's a slur on bourgeois.
Oh, right. I finally found a word I can't pronounce. Okay. Born bougie, but always felt more working class on the inside? No problem. Taking on a proletariat identity is a great way to subvert the class binary. I digress. The bright side of Bustle's listicle is that it has inspired me to create one of my own. Here are 9 actual things that really do make you a better feminist than everybody else.
Okay. No, me first.
Yes.
The one good thing about this Bustle's listicle is it inspired me to create. It inspired me to create this list, this beautiful list. That is the one good thing that came of this.
Were it not for the Holocaust, then events would not have conspired for me to be born. So the Holocaust was a good thing.
Exactly. It's, I don't know, it's a little egotistical.
Okay. Just all right. I'm going to go.
Okay.
The feminists are eating each other now. So now we know that not everything is feminist, right? So there is something that is not feminist. So they can start qualifying what is goddamn feminist. But of course, we'll have Bustle come back and say, no, everything really is feminist and everyone is a feminist and blah, 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 feminism. But it's like, we have now... What is this? We have feminist whatever current against Bustle now, which are both feminist publications fighting over what is feminism. I think that's amusing.
No, I like it, and I would love to see these the two authors mud wrestle
over what is the true feminism.
Yeah. No, and like whoever wins just takes it all. Right? Now it is them. They dictate what is feminist and what is not. We'll finally have an authority. We'll finally be able to say, the woman who won this mud wrestling match says that this is a feminist thing, right? And therefore you can't say, oh, it's just the radicals who, oh, that's not real feminism. Oh, blah, blah, blah. No, we would actually finally have a pope of feminism. It would be beautiful.
Yeah. Well, we could actually finally criticize feminism, and nobody could say, well, that's not feminism. Any criticism, you see that how it seems to work is anytime you make a criticism of feminism, that isn't feminism, but every time you compliment feminism, that is feminism.
So or even if it's something that isn't feminism at all, they'll still take credit for it.
Very often a feminist pope will come along, like Steve Shives or Richard Carrier, and they immediately become the focus of attention. They fucking break down within months and everyone realizes what a tosser they are. This is why no one wants to accept responsibility for feminism, because
Oh, yeah, no.
You're taking on responsibility for something indefensible.
It's not a good place to be in charge of something like that, so.
Yeah. All right, let's go to the first bullet point.
Okay, bullet point number one.
Number one, being a woman.
A woman. Is that like being Cool Whip? Or Will Wheaton? Being a woman.
Okay. You could be a very powerful ally to feminists, even if you are male, but you're never fully going to get the female experience because women are the group of humans who are oppressed under patriarchy as a class, and men are the dominant group of humans in that system. Women are the ones who must lead the movement towards their own liberation. Being a woman is central to being a feminist because feminism is a movement that is by and for women. While men are also impacted negatively by patriarchy, masculinity sucks too. In the end, it is men who have always benefited from it, and women who have suffered under it, at the hands of men. The best way to support the feminist movement as a man is to challenge other men, and male privilege, and male entitlement, and male violence. In fact, this is a great help and saves us the time of having to constantly be explaining to every single man we meet that we are not actually sex toys. You can do all this without calling yourself a feminist. Show, don't tell, boys. Okay.
All right. It begins.
No boys allowed.
I love the way she contradicts herself, like between, like in the space of two sentences. Although men also suffer under patriarchy, right? Blah blah. Masculinity sucks too, right? The truth is that all men benefit, and all women suffer, and men don't suffer under patriarchy.
When bad things happen to you, they're not happening, dear.
Well, when bad things happen to you, it's really just a sign of your privilege.
All right. I'm just glad that she's out with it, because this is really what feminism says. And this seems to be the divide between radicals and so-called moderate feminists. Radicals will actually, if I ask them, do men oppress women? Radical feminists will say yes. Moderates will just squirm around actually taking a strong stance on it because they know that it's in some ways it's an appalling statement when you consider the implications. So I don't know. I know props for being honest, Megan. Props for being honest.
No, agreed. And it's like the mainstream feminists will say, well, women are oppressed by patriarchy, and patriarchy does not equal men, right? And okay, it's just the system men set up to benefit themselves at women's expense. But that's not men doing that. It's not men. It's just this amorphous thing that makes men do horrible things to women.
Yeah, it's not explicitly men to blame, but we have to blame someone for it, and we might as well blame men, so it's just a loophole, folks.
It is. You know what? I think it's the patriarchy that's making Mike's computer do that. And hopefully we aren't giving any of our viewers an epileptic fit.
Yeah, maybe for now, Mike, just go to your icon, because it's like really...
Although I really enjoy watching him acting out the Purple Mole voice.
Yeah, it is great. It's a hard decision to make.
Like, I could live with the flashing.
Yeah. I'll turn off in between readings, shall I?
Yes, okay. Yes, that'll work.
That will work. That will do.
All right, so something I want to set up is that once again we see feminists treating as axiomatic the idea of patriarchy, the idea that men in charge means men benefit, even though there's actual research into the nature of psychology that would suggest that isn't so.
Yeah.
This is seen as axiomatic. So in other words, they believe that patriarchy, male privilege, male entitlement, male violence, whatever, these things describe reality. So if the feminism that Megan is talking about is describing reality, which would make it a science. Well, if it's a science hypothesis, how does Megan see it being falsified? I mean, that would be recognizing feminism as a scientific hypothesis would mean that Megan Murphy would acknowledge or recognize a way that it could be falsified. Because if it isn't falsifiable, it's not scientific. So sure. let's go on to the next bullet point.
All right.
I feel it's time.
Alrighty, hello.
It is time. It is time.
Number two. Understanding that feminism is not a feeling or an identity, but a political movement. Feminism is not about wearing a t-shirt that says you're a feminist. It isn't about saying you're a feminist just for the sake of saying it, even if you have no interest in liberating women from patriarchal oppression. It's okay to be new to feminism and to be learning. You don't have to know everything about the movement in order to join, but you do have to understand that it is not a malleable word, a logo, or a marketable product. No one would ever say socialism is whatever you make of it. You do you, bro, because that is stupid and also factually incorrect. If you
I think that's true. I think that's true. You can't say that socialism is whatever you make of it. You just do your own socialism, and you can do that by, you know, she makes very good points about Marxism and socialism and how they are definable things with definable, you know, aspects to them, and that you can't just say you're a socialist and have it be true. You can't just say you're a Marxist and have it be true.
In theory, anyway, but they seem to be using the word social to mean whatever they want it to mean. I say even the pitchfork-wielding witch hunts counts as social justice. Anything that doesn't pertain to individual needs. Yeah. Fuck the individual. Society is what's important.
Okay. I'm just gonna deke in there. Okay. So that we now have two groups of feminists. One who will explicitly say that society is oppressive towards women. And this is the most important oppression to address. I mean, let's be clear.
And that it's men's fault.
And it's men's fault. This is an oppression. The oppression of women is the most important oppression to address. It's more important than ableism. It's more important than homophobia. It's more important than racism. It's more important than ethnocentrism. It's more important than all those other oppressions that resulted in people being thrown out of work for protesting them, for being killed, for being subject to genocide. The impression that we need to see history through is patriarchal oppression, which is the worst oppression ever. And that means that as women, as white women, not only are white women not culpable in a history of oppression, but they were subject to more oppression than, for example, the slaves on their plantations. Now, having put that out there, I would like feminists as a group to either the feminists who agree that patriarchal oppression of women is the worst oppression ever, more worse than anything else, it's the impression by which we need to see society throughout history, which is what they're saying. I mean, otherwise, why call it patriarchal oppression? Why call a society patriarchy? Why not call it a racialarchy or an ablearchy or some other
nationalist or something like that? Yeah.
If they agree that women are oppressed and patriarchal oppression is the worst, they need to kick out the feminists who don't agree. They need to kick them out. They need to start saying, get the fuck out of feminism. Or, alternatively, those feminists who seem to think that feminism isn't about saying that women were oppressed throughout history, that patriarchal oppression is the most important oppression to redress, et cetera, they need to kick out the feminists who do say it. Because now it's like a ratchet effect.
Oh yeah, no, it's ridiculous. And you know, like one of the things that I've heard some radicals actually posit is that racism and genocides and xenophobia and all of these other ways of hating the ways people hate each other and treat each other poorly, classism and all of that. That was all essentially built on the model of class oppression of women, as in men learned how to do it by oppressing women and seeing that you know, this is a great thing. Now we benefit from oppressing women. Let's go oppress those guys over there now, right? And It absolutely boggles my mind that they could think that all of the different ways that people can be shitty to other groups of people, right? They all were sort of, you know, men just trained. They trained on, you know, on oppressing women, and then just sort of created all of these other dynamics just out of, you know, oh yeah, no, it worked when we did it to these gals over here. Let's do it to all of these black people over here. Right? Like, how,
okay.
I don't even.
Yeah. Well, it's not just that. It's like what I was getting at as a point is you got,
oh yeah, no, you have, schism. You have the complete, yeah.
You have the one side that wants to say that it really is almost like a battle between, like, men and women are at each other's throats. If men succeed, women will die. If women succeed, men will die. Or I don't know what. They probably don't believe
Learn
that.
Learn how to be human beings.
Yeah, something like that. But anyway, it's like this horrible, vicious battle throughout history that men have been waging against women. And they have these feminists who say that this is feminism. And then you have the feminism say, oh no, it's all about equality. It's all about equality. And they hide behind each other. I'm saying they need to make their decision what feminism is about. Because if feminism is about equality, and it allows everyone to come to the table to determine what equality is, I could be behind that. But I'm not behind these feminists who say it is about opposing oppression of women and then hiding behind the dictionary definition of equality whenever they get criticized.
Yeah.
What do they call it? The Mott and Motley?
Mott and Bailey.
Mott and Bailey. Yeah.
And what is the rubber button?
The rubber button. All right. Shall we do the next point?
Moving right along.
All right. Are we going to point three? Because we only got halfway through point two.
Do we want to finish up point two?
Let's finish up.
We'll be here all night, won't we?
Oh, no. Let's do it. Let's do point two. I sense a rant.
Okay. Point two, part B. If you think that objectifying women, or street harassment, or male entitlement, or gender stereotypes, or sexualizing violence against women is good and okay, you aren't a feminist. Taking a selfie, or getting married, or wearing stilettos, or making a bunch of money does not equate to feminism. Yet feminists are allowed to do these things. See how that works? Because feminism isn't about you, as an individual, feeling personally good, or empowered in the moment. You can feel empowered, but that doesn't necessarily produce feminism. Similarly, feeling good does not equate to empowerment. Empowerment in the context of feminism means social empowerment for a group of marginalized people, in this case women. This is why, for example, posing nude and feeling sexy in a fashion or porn magazine might feel good for the individual doing it. They will receive positive reinforcement, feel attractive, profit financially, etc., but does not constitute empowerment, as it does not lift up women as a class.
What the fuck? Well, then, okay, so an individual woman, any individual woman who engages in this activity actually feels empowered and actually profits financially and feels attractive and gets positive reinforcement. So any individual woman actually benefits from this, but she should feel bad about it because all women don't benefit from what she does? What kind of hive mind stupidity is this?
Yeah, like, I know. It's all a matter of, it's essentially we are Borg, right?
No, but does it qualify in any other circumstance? Like if a woman has an incredible ability to do math and she gets a Nobel Prize, does she have to then say, oh, I'm sorry, feminism, I've empowered myself at the expense of the sisterhood? Like, or is it just sexuality? Like, I got something that the other women's didn't get, and I feel bad, because why? If a woman is beautiful, or if she's smart, she deserves what she can get out of, in many cases, a very disciplined application of her talents, be it beauty or intelligence. She deserves it! And you deserve to back the fuck off and let her enjoy the fruits of her own labor.
Well, and on top of that, like, okay, so she did freaking do really good in math, and she did get the Nobel Prize. Oh, my goodness. Wouldn't feminists say, you know, she's breaking barriers. She's bursting, you know, punching a hole in the ceiling that holds all other women down. She's because this is an activity, this is a way of distinguishing herself of which they approve, right? As opposed to posing nude on page 3, right? Or topless on page 3. That's something of which they do not approve, right? So that is not empowering to all women. What is empowering to all women is, you know, storming the male bastions of power, right? One woman, Boudica, who wins that Nobel Prize, is we can be proud of her, and she's raising all women up by doing that because she's doing what we want her to do with her life, even if she's only doing it for herself.
I get the feeling that I get the feeling that this seems to be really inspired more by jealousy.
Oh, yeah.
Than it is by empowerment. So I get the feeling that even if a woman did get a Nobel Prize and she didn't supplicate appropriately to feminism by saying, "Oh, feminism helped lift me up. Feminism, without the strong shoulders of feminism, a little woman like me could never have done this thing. Oh, thank you, feminist. Kiss the ring of the godmother." You know, that I think that they would also start implicating her as somehow disempowering other women. Because she would be saying, in essence, she would be denying this role of victim. Women can only succeed insofar as they support the overarching feminist narrative that women as a class are victims. They can't say, hey, I succeeded, why didn't you?
This is why they hated Margaret Thatcher, right? And it wasn't just because of her politics, and I can understand why a bunch of Marxist fucking feminists would really hate Margaret Thatcher's politics. But it was also because she essentially said, you know what, I got here on my own. I played with the big boys. I have no reason to thank the women's movement. I owe them nothing. And in fact, feminism is poison. Bye. Mic drop, and then she walked off the stage. So her achievement, that's not, you know, that's actually a detriment to women. That's not empowering women. That's actually, she's not empowering anybody by her example because she didn't do it the feminist approved way.
So basically,
even if she had thanked feminism and said, I owe my success to the women's movement, they would have taken one look at her conservative politics and they would have been like, we are not touching that poop.
Well, to be honest, whatever you do or whatever politics you have, as long as your speech at the end of the day grovels towards the women's movement, they'll be fine. I forget who the actress was at the Oscars or whatever who got an award and immediately started talking about the wage gap and how unfair it is.
Patricia Arquette, was it?
Possibly. Yeah, some rich silver spoon woman standing up there saying, it's a crime that women get paid less than...
Oh, yeah, it's a real crime. Well, okay, yeah, and in Hollywood, yeah, women get paid a little bit less than men, typically, right? Even leading, the titular role in a movie starring a woman, and a very, very, you know, a big box office star will maybe get less than an equivalent role for a male. But we're talking, 5% less, 20% less. We're not talking, 100 times less, like we are when we compare men and women in porn, men and women in high fashion modeling, men and women in all kinds of things where women make 10, 20, 50, even 100 times as much as men do.
Yeah,
and I imagine it's much the same in the high ends of acting as it is in drama schools. It's about 90% women to 10% men, so men are more likely to get the roles. Much more likely to get the roles because there's less competition. You know.
So
a lot
there
more
you go.
Than actors out there.
Generally, yeah, I think so.
Okay.
All right.
Number 3, sir.
Number 3.
Okay. here I am. Hello again. Right.
Hello again. Well, it's all good to see you.
Number three, cutting out this anti-intellectual bullshit. OMG, you guys, thinking is not a bad thing. Of course you don't need a degree to do feminism. Sheesh. But by that same token, all this fuck your ivory tower ideology, fuck theory, fuck yeah stuff is counterproductive and ignorant. There is no activism without ideology. Ideology is the body of ideas that frames a political movement. We need that. Otherwise, how the fuck do we know what we're doing? What's that? We're just taking selfies and shouting intersectionality at each other on Twitter? Good then. Fuck ideology. Fuck movements. Fuck yeah. Likewise, understanding the history of this movement is a good thing. It ensures that we don't reinvent the wheel over and over again. It ensures we don't rewrite history. Effectively erasing the work and activism of thousands and thousands of women who fought for the rights we enjoy today. Understanding how to think critically. Understanding feminist ideology. Understanding feminist history. These things are not for snobbish elites. These are things that are foundational. Otherwise we achieve nothing and are left blindly screaming slap power into the virtual abyss. Education and academia are not bad things. They are good things that have been made inaccessible to many people throughout the world and or have left many of us with crippling debt. But education is not the problem. The system is. Free post-secondary school is a feminist issue. Hashtag it.
No, free post-secondary school should not be a feminist issue.
Free post-secondary school should not be a thing. It should not be a thing. Because you know why? Because it's not free.
Okay,
it's not free.
Karen, let me finish my point. Free post-secondary school is not a feminist thing because if you're going to even consider free post-secondary school, consider it for the trades or the degrees that actually create employable human beings.
Tech degrees, two-year diplomas.
Yeah. No, you don't get to sit on your ass and take a degree in professional nagging. That's ridiculous.
And then complain that you can't pay off your $60,000 of debt with your job at Starbucks. or probably it would be more common for it not to be a job as a barista at Starbucks, but a series of jobs that you would move one to the next to the next to the next crappy job because you're such a miserable cunt that you don't stay in a job for more than 6 months before people are so sick of you they just want you to just fucking walk off a cliff, right?
Jeez, it sounds like you're almost talking about personal experience.
Oh man, there are some people that I have worked with that are so miserable to be around and like just absolutely no sense of humor, offended at everything, they're toxic to work with. But the whole post-secondary school thing, like how on earth does she think it's free, right? It's not free. Somebody's paying for it. And here's the problem, right? Because when we had, when student loans became guaranteed, right? So the bank knows it's getting its money. It's getting its money one way or another because that debt can't be expunged in a bankruptcy, right? So they know they're getting their money and all of a sudden, right? Because giving a student loan is essentially making an investment. The bank is making an investment. And when those debts, could have been expunged in a bankruptcy, they would actually have to make a good investment. They would have to make a safe, good investment by essentially sending the kids to school who really should be going to school in academic courses, who maybe, you know, who aren't the ones who, you know, they probably should be a mechanic or a pipe fitter or a welder or something like that, but their parents really want them to go to university, right? And they maybe just don't have the marks for it. No, now they'll just give loans to everybody, and the university gets all of their money, and demand is increasing like crazy. So you have all these students now who have this artificial system that's making it making them able to attend university when otherwise they might not have, right? So then, okay, prices of tuition, like university in the U.S., the tuition costs have gone up something like 30 times, at 30 times the rate of inflation. And part of that is that anybody can go, and a lot of these people who go they don't finish because they shouldn't have gone in the first place. They weren't university material. They were a two-year tech degree material. You know, they were an apprenticeship material. You know, they weren't a four-year fucking engineering course kind of person, right? So, and then you have all of this debt these people are leaving school with, no guaranteed jobs. The university doesn't care. They got their money. The banks don't care. They're going to get their money one way or another, right? If the banks, if the loans could be expunged in a bankruptcy, then banks going to loan these students this money would say, well, you know, it's projected that that we're going to have a glut of engineers on the market in the next 10, 20 years. So maybe you should take something else. We're not going to fund, we're not going to invest in you getting that degree. But here, we're going to be, you know, we're going to have not enough of this, not enough of that, and not enough architects. Maybe try that, right? Instead, it's just a free-for-all of people taking, wasting fucking time, spending money they don't have, right, that they are going to have to pay back someday, no matter what, on something that's not probably going to pay off, particularly if you went into sociology or gender studies or interdisciplinary bullshit, right? And, like, what the fuck are we doing? And now we're saying, oh, we'll just get the government to pay for all of it. Yeah, the government doesn't have any money. That's our money.
But here's the other thing. If we do this, and women are freely able to take degrees where they don't actually have to, they don't actually, there's nothing, like, there's no stop, like, oh, you're going to end up having to owe $100,000. They can just freely take it. What do you think is going to happen to the wage gap? Because somebody has to pay for this. And it's going to be the people, the men, who go into the professions that actually make money.
Yeah, and the trades.
Yeah, and the trades.
Trades can make you a lot of fucking money, let me tell you.
Okay, let's move on to number four.
Plumbers have dirty hands, but they have fat wallets.
Oh, wait, before we move on to number four, cutting this anti-intellectualist bullshit out. In number one, I said, if feminism describes reality, it is a science. And if it is a science, feminist hypothesis should be falsifiable. And feminists should be able to tell me when I ask, what would falsify feminist hypothesis? Feminist academics, at the very least, should be able to say it.
Yeah.
And go ahead. Ask a feminist academic, what would falsify feminist hypothesis, in your opinion?
Well, but they don't know, because they don't even know what that is. They don't even know what the scientific method is. They just know a bunch of fribbity-frabberty postmodernist frickin' dialectic. That's all they know. They think that philosophy, which is gibberish, in my opinion, is the equivalent of a science.
Well, it was all encapsulated in point number three. It started with stop all this anti-intellectual shit, and by the time it was at the end of the paragraph, it was, so we should get free schooling. You know, they pretend to be altruistic, and it doesn't take long before they reveal that it's selfishness masquerading as altruism.
Then she could take women's studies for the rest of her life, and she'd never have to get a job.
Or institutions could saddle young, stupid women or naive women with a huge debt on something that they'll never get a job in, and they've just basically turned them into, and not only never give a job in, but they've actively learned for 4 years to revoke and to deny those personal and social skills that might give them some initiative, some passion, some ability to do something. They've spent four years... Some 4 years unlearning passion and ambition as a woman in women's studies.
And agency. And, you know, confidence in yourself and,
yeah. And you're replacing it with this fragile, triggered, sensitive bitterness. Okay, let's move on to number four.
Number four.
Number four. Understanding that feminism is not about being politically correct. Please don't misunderstand me on this one. Being a feminist means one must be thoughtful about one's words and actions. Saying and doing whatever the fuck we want whenever we want it is selfish, irresponsible, and juvenile. But our efforts to avoid being self-indulgent, offensive teenagers need not lead to political correctness. Being a feminist means you think critically about the world around you. You take nothing at face value when you question the status quo. You tell the truth, even if that truth makes people uncomfortable. Change makes people uncomfortable. Questioning dominant ideology makes people uncomfortable. Being politically correct means making sure you don't piss anyone off, and it means you toe the party line. They've spelled toe, T-O-E.
That's wow. What it is supposed to be.
No, it's T-O-W.
No, towing the party line, when you toe the line, you get your toes back behind the line.
Okay, all right. The party line might well be a progressive or liberal party line. It might even be a party line that some have deemed feminist, but it's still a party line. The moment you stop thinking for yourself, start repeating mantras your peers repeat without thinking about whether or not that mantra actually makes sense. Stop being brave, stop questioning the ideology and messages behind popular discourse, is the moment you become not an agent of change, but a lemming. So many feminists today are scared to say anything controversial, and is depressing as fuck. Young feminists are afraid to speak out or question popular discourse, lest they be labeled bigots or some version of phobe. Instead of pushing back, we've become pushovers. Dissent is a good thing. Your ability to think for yourself and to question ideas that are assumed to be correct is critical. Fuck being politically correct.
Megan.
Good luck with that. Good luck Megan. With that, my darling.
Okay, Megan. Do your feminist beliefs hurt women? You have to question ideas that are assumed to be correct? Well, I'm questioning the automatic assumption that feminism is beneficial to women in any shape or form.
Well, you know, honestly,
have you ever asked that?
I have to agree with her that political correctness is like, fuck it. Just fuck it. Ask questions, dissent, but that doesn't just apply to feminists. It applies to people who sit in opposition to feminism. They should be allowed to express ideas, challenge the status quo of feminism, right? Pick apart their ideology and point at the things that they think are wrong. They deserve and not be politically correct about it. So, you know what? Megan and I are on the same page about this. We absolutely are. Being politically correct sucks, and I say fuck it. And I'm not going to worry about hurting feminists' feelings because Megan Murphy said that that's the way I should be. And I am not going to shy away from telling the truth just because it'll make some feminist uncomfortable, right? And I'm not going to shy away from challenging their ideas just because it upsets them.
Critical thinking led me to question feminism and find that it has absolutely no basis in fact. And in fact, not only that, but it bears a very suspicious resemblance to other older forms of women playing the damsel in order to control and manipulate society. And this is what you're doing. Like she is very clearly outlaid that she thinks that women are defined as victims because they're women.
Yes.
Well, how is that different than saying women's role is as a damsel, unless you can support it factually? So, I unfortunately don't see much facts supporting feminism. Real facts. And what I would consider to be real facts would be looking at the situation both in terms of how it affects women, but also in terms of how it affects men. And also looking into the research on how human societies are structured, or even how we see things psychologically. You know, the fact that when people are perceived to have more agency, they get less compassion. So the more overt agency a group of people has in society, the less compassion they get. Which is why, if you look throughout history, oppressive regimes tried to make it so that the oppressed were actually the enforcers of oppression. So you'll see Jewish concentration camp guards, black overseers, you'll see Janissaries, the sons of Christian slaves, essentially keeping Christian slaves under control of the Ottoman Empire. You see this consistently. The oppression is done by one rung up from the bottom. Very rarely from the top, and when it's done from the top, you almost always see revolution as the next step. So I'll put that out there.
I think it's interesting to note that in point two, she says, and I quote, because feminism isn't about you as an individual feeling personally good or empowered in the moment. And in point number four, she says, and I quote, the moment you stop thinking for yourself, ... is the moment you become not an agent of change, but a lemming. It takes 2 points for her to completely contradict herself. So there's nothing clear about this message at all, as far as I can see.
Well, yeah.
But clearly we have to move on to number five.
Yeah, we got to get through this soon, because, see, unlike Mike, I don't get to sit and drink and smoke during this one, because
I don't get much
smoke-free office building.
I'm not getting much opportunity to smoke either. Let's get through this. All right, number five?
Number five!
Not being ageist. At what point did ageism become acceptable in feminism? Oh, right, the third wave. Okay, so we understand that rebellious teenagers want to "you're not my real mom" slams door their elders, but we are not rebellious teenagers. We are adults. And if you are a feminist, it is unacceptable to make second wave an insult. That is some woman-hating, anti-feminist, ageist garbage. And if you want to pull that shit, congratulations, you're doing patriarchy. Keep your ignorance and keep perpetuating sexist notions that women who are no longer youthful are silly, old-fashioned, prudish fuddy-duddies clutching their pearls all the way to the old folks' home where they can stick to bingo. But know that you're no feminist. Older movement women know more than you, and we aren't going anywhere without them.
Oh, God.
This is pretty tepid.
I just love it because, you know, if I recall a blog post. It was, I don't know if you remember this person. She went by the name of Ozymandias, and I think she was she's in thick with Noah Brand,
who, yes, I remember them very well,
with the Good Men Project. Anyhow, they did a blog together for a while called "No Seriously, What About the Men's?" You know, it was supposed to be this kind of feminist blog writing about, it was supposed to be like essentially the Good Men Project 2.0. And they wrote a post on after the death of Mary Daly saying, you know, I think it's time that feminism actually disowned this woman, right? And anybody who wants to know who Mary Daly is, she was a tenured professor at Boston College. She was so sexist that she banned men from many of her classes. I think she was called on the carpet for it repeatedly and sanctioned by the university, but couldn't be fired, so she just kept doing it. She said in an interview once that she agreed with Sally Miller Gerhardt, who was the one at the time who was advocating bringing the male population down to about 5-10% of the population in order to get rid of all of the violence and rape and you know, rape of the land and pollution and everything, all of the bad things that men do and only men do. And she said something along the lines of, I think that if humanity is going to survive, it'll require a decontamination of the earth, and I think that this will be accompanied by a process that reduces the population of males down to 10% or so of the population. She thought this was a great idea, too. She was like a horrible, horrible bigot. There are people like Andrea Dworkin, who said it's often difficult to tell between rape and seduction. In seduction, the rapist sometimes buys a bottle of wine, right? That's the only difference. He's a rapist in both cases, but he might have sprung for a bottle of wine in the second case, right? Catherine McKinnon, you know, women don't have the political power to consent to sex, heterosexual sex, ever, and therefore every single instance of heterosexual sex is, even with enthusiastic consent, is rape, because the woman's consent is vitiated by her inability to refuse consent under this political system, right? So just all of this fucked upness, right? I think Catherine McKinnon, said that rape wasn't just something men do. It was actually part of a concerted campaign to terrorize women as a group. So it's actually like men get together and talk, you know, and like they participate in a conspiracy whether it's a conscious one or a subconscious one, they participate in a conspiracy to use rape as a tool of subjugation, right? As a group, to keep women as a group in their place, right? It's part of a concerted campaign. So, I mean, some of these fucking women were completely fucking batshit, and you have this younger generation of feminists, many of whom are still fucking loopy and batshit, but they're at least more moderate than that, right? And they want to disown them, and I don't fucking blame them. I really don't. I wouldn't touch freaking Catherine McKinnon with a 10-foot pole, right? There was even some second waiver out of the University of Melbourne a while ago who in a speech said that heterosexuality is not natural. It's heterosexual sex is not a natural act, right? So literally, this woman believes that the only form of sex that's engaged in by every single sexually reproducing species on the planet, penis and vagina, heterosexual sex, is unnatural, right? And it's just a form of oppression that's been imposed by men on women to control them, right? So, I mean, like, I don't blame these fucking third waivers for wanting to distance themselves from that. This is not a matter of ageism. This is a matter of you ladies were fucking out, you're loopy.
Yeah, well, that actually segues quite nicely into point number six. Go for
point
it, Mike.
Okie dokie, there's two things to turn on. Right. Not accusing feminists of hating sex and men like it's a bad thing. Women are allowed to hate men and sex. Hating men and sex is perfectly natural. Men and sex with men has been a source of trauma for countless women over centuries. It is also perfectly natural to love particular men and to enjoy having sex. None of these realities are things that should be used by feminists to insult, attack, or dismiss other feminists. By accusing feminists who challenge male violence of hating sex or hating men, you are reinforcing heteronormative garbage and feeding into stereotypes that say feminists are just angry because they aren't getting fucked enough. These tropes are connected to rape culture. It is the idea that men can fuck women into passivity or fuck them straight. It is the idea that only fuckable women are real women. It is the idea that women need men in order to be whole beings and to matter, that they only exist in relation to men. These are anti-feminist ideas. Whether or not a woman likes men or sex has no bearing on her worth and whether or not her life, ideas, words, or activism has meaning. What feminism fights against is the very idea that women's relationships to men are what make them visible and valuable as humans. It's similar to attacking a woman by saying she's ugly. Women don't exist to be looked at or to fuck men. They get to exist all on their own. Take your lesbophobic sexism back to the MRA forum. They'll love you there.
Oh my god,
alright. Okay, I just have to say one thing. Lesbophobic sexism. So you are actually saying, you are actually applying heteronormative norms to men's rights activism. Because we have actually a very high proportion of gay and bisexual men in men's rights.
And transgender. Men and women.
Men and women. In fact, I think it might be higher than in feminism. So you are essentially saying, go take your notion that women are defined by their sexuality to a men's rights forum. Well, that's assuming that men are defined by women's sexuality.
Well, I would take this woman seriously as in saying these things is anti-feminist. I can't think of her now without this loopy British accent. Because women this, right? Okay, well, so every time a guy gets told he's just bitter because he can't get laid, every time a guy gets told he just can't get a girlfriend, no woman would want him, every time an MRA gets told to shut up because, some girl dumped him and now he just hates all women, every time men are told to man up, right, stop being pussies, stop whining, and help the women, you know, he for she, all of these things, every single fucking, and every, the entirety of feminism, right? The entirety of patriarchy is centered around defining men by how they affect women.
Yep. They're either villains or they're either villains or heroes of women. Nothing else.
Yeah, and so like how is this a sexist thing to do? Or even an anti-feminist thing to do to say, well, you know, there was a video that I was commenting on just today, and some woman came on and she said, you know, you should just go get yourself laid and then maybe you'd be, you know, less of a misogynistic fuck or something like that, right? You're just mad because we don't want to sleep with you. And, okay, like, okay. Men and women do relate to each other. Men and women coexist in society, and they are male and female are a binary, whether we like it or not, right? And there's not everybody fits into it perfectly, but there is a binary there. And of course, when we talk about women, we're talking about them. When we measure how well women are doing, we should be measuring it against how well men are doing. And if we measure how well men are doing, we should be measuring it against how the same thing for women. That's just how you do it. That's just how we think of these things. And it's not one side or the other that does it. Everybody does it. All sides.
The other thing here is, she's saying that women are not defined in relation to men, but that's all feminism does, yeah. Is define women in relation to men's actions. Yeah. That's it. Women are just a reaction to men's actions in the feminist cosmology, which is, it's worse than saying that women like sex or that women should like sex or that women should like men. I don't really care. Women, I don't believe in imperatives like that. If you don't like men, so what? Go live in your feminist lesbian commune and get raped and beaten. Sorry, was that a little bit resentful? But yeah, the statistics show that there's a really high rate of rape and abuse in lesbian relationships. Is that homophobic now? Is it homophobic to recognize it or not recognize it? I don't know anymore. Anyway,
I don't know either.
Apparently, it's not homophobic to suggest that gay men are all even more misogynistic than straight men.
The rules become more and more convoluted and insane. But I'm going to hazard a guess that throughout countless centuries, more women enjoyed sex than didn't. That's how we came about.
Yeah, no, it's just absolutely, like, there's a reason why people have a sex drive. There's a reason why people have libido. It's because the people who didn't have libido didn't pass on their non-libido genes. It's very, very simple. And the ones who have libido went out and managed to get themselves laid and had some kids. That's how it works. That's why we like sex, because sex makes babies, right? Even if we don't want babies, we still like sex because sex makes babies.
Yeah, well, and it's also bonding activity. It's an intimacy. And I'd like to point out that this anti-sexuality strain is so very Puritan and Christian. Well, not all strands of Christianity have it, and I'm sure there's moderates who don't believe in this shit, but this idea that men pollute women with their sexuality, this idea that women shouldn't necessarily enjoy sex with men. What the is this actually supposed to be progressive or regressive? Because what I'm seeing here, what I see Megan selling for women is this idea of being defined by men's actions, by being defined by being victims of men, and also this idea that having sex with a man and enjoying it somehow is wrong, is bad.
Yeah.
And if she wants to refocus the idea that sexuality with men is something, well, obviously it's not feminist. Of course, hating men and hating sex, I think in her parlance, is feminist. But liking men and liking sex isn't feminist. Well, thank you for being honest about it. Fuck you!
Okay. All right, let's move on.
Was no boys, isn't it? Point number one was, you got to be a woman to be a feminist. It's the no boys club from the get-go. Yeah.
Okay, but before we get into the next point, I think I'd like to take this moment to dive into the mailbag a bit before we get into the next point. And the next point, for anybody who's listening, the next point is when Megan goes into not being an MRA. Why you should not be an MRA as a woman. And I figured before we do that, we should actually discuss some experiences of actual men. All right.
Okay.
Anonymous writes, "Hi, Badgers. I wanted to tell you about when I was raped and how I can never report it for the sake of my rapist's son. I had known her for a few months, and we had occasionally hooked up. She was a divorced, the husband's decision as he fell in love with his ex and left my rapist for the other woman, has a great fun chipper personality. So being 22 at the time and not minding older women, about 15 years older, I hooked up with her a few times. She, however, was a bit of a drinker. Guess that helped her get through the stress of the day, as her ex is an asshole who is clearly using his son as a pawn in their now antagonistic relationship. When she raped me, she was drunk, clearly, as all my attempts to stop her were met with slurred speech and rougher than normal physical pushes and prods. I didn't want to hurt her, as she at the moment was a friend, or her, me, so I let her. Yeah, afterwards I requested that she take me home, and she did as she attempted to sober herself up. I have seen her occasionally since, and she still acts like everything is fine, and that she still wishes to keep a sexual relationship with me. I've dodged in various ways and feel like I was violated by that night, but I can't bring myself to ever report her due to her son. Her son is a great kid who deserves better than what his father provides for him, and that would be his mother, who raped me. She'd lose custody if I press charges, and I can't do that to him. So I'll go to my grave never telling anyone I have a relationship and or kids with or anyone else about what happened that night. I will go to my grave another one of those unreported male sexual victims of female aggressors. I entrust you with this because I know you fight for men like me, and I need to know how it helps to hear someone yelling about how unfair it is. Thank you." Okay, well, there you go. There's one more. There's one more. But let's just that's one of the reasons why I fight for men's rights.
I can't muster up much of a response to that other than like, holy shit, and I hope you're doing okay.
Yeah. So he let it happen because he was afraid of anyone getting hurt.
That's typical. That's actually really, really typical with men who are sexually assaulted by women, is that they don't resist because they're worried about hurting her.
Or in this case, he was also worried that she would hurt him. And I guess he figured it wasn't a big deal to just submit. Okay. Anonymous writes, "Dear Honey Badgers, I've drafted this letter 3 times in hopes of succinctly relating how great I think you and your podcasts are. This letter is being written in regards to podcast number 22, Male Sexuality Revisited. I honestly don't know where to begin. I recently discovered Men Going Their Own Way and the Men's Rights Movement, which coincidentally led me to the Honey Badger's initial podcast on male sexuality. Being a husband or father has never been high on my list of life goals, and this puts me in sharp contrast with many of my friends who are bent on achieving the American dream, cookie-cutter lifestyle that consists of an office job, a spouse, 2 to 3 kids, and McMansion in the suburbs. Because of this, I'm often the recipient of empty platitudes and smug shaming tactics like, you just haven't found the right woman yet, or you gotta settle down eventually, or you're just afraid of commitment. But I digress. This letter is simply a brief and humble thank you for the previously mentioned podcast on male sexuality. What moved me most about that episode were the closing statements, particularly those made by Karen. As someone who has spent most of his life seen as nothing but a fat ass, and recently graduated to barrel-chested, which doesn't sound that bad to me, I've only recently grown comfortable with what my body looks like. I'm inclined to think that's because I'm a hit in my 30s and no longer give a flying shit what people have to say about my looks. But hearing what Karen had to say in her closing remarks prompted a feeling I don't think I've ever had before in my life. I felt beautiful. For the first time in my life, as a man, I felt truly and sincerely beautiful. I wanted to thank you all from the bottom of my heart, as well as thank you for the Raginings and Rantzerkers, just 2 on a very short list of things that genuinely entertain me throughout my consistently sluggish work days. I'll be tuning in, guys. Keep it going."
You are beautiful, bro. You are beautiful. I can't see you, but you're beautiful.
Yeah, that's I just give this a little taste of why we do what we do as women who advocate for men's rights. Because, you know what, I think men deserve to feel beautiful too, and also to be recognized when they're raped. But let's see what Megan thinks we advocate for. All right, Mike, go on, take it away.
All righty, Roo. Number 7. Not being an MRA. Speaking of MRAs, You know what definitely makes you a better feminist than everyone else? Fighting for women's rights, not men's rights. And by that I mean, rather than fighting for the rights of men who want to pay for blowjobs, try fighting for women's human rights, which include the ability to pay rent and feed themselves without having to provide men with blowjobs. An often overlooked but pivotal aspect of feminism is the idea that women are human. That's right, we're radical like that, and because we are human, we deserve things like food and water and housing, and we should have access to these things without having to fuck strange men or be subjected to abuse. If you think men are entitled to sex, you're doing it wrong. Nobody is entitled to sex. It is not a human right. Your fetish for Asian women, schoolgirl porn, anal, or calling women whores while you pull their hair and choke them is not some innate part of your kinky sexuality. It just means you're turned on by dehumanizing women. Bye, Felicia. What the fuck does any of that have to do with men's rights advocates? I'm so fucking confused.
No. Okay, here's the thing. She's twisting the sex workers' rights movement into a men's rights project, right? So what she's saying is that the push to legalize or decriminalize prostitution is actually fighting for men's right to pay for blowjobs, right? And she's saying that instead of that, we should criminalize the fuck out of it and then just give women free money because as human beings, right, they have a right to have their shit paid for, right? Any woman can have her shit paid for without sucking dick. She just needs to go get a job, right? But oddly enough, sucking dick pays more than minimum wage. Isn't that interesting?
And actually, I've heard testimonials from sex workers that they said they felt more exploited in an office job than they did running their own small business.
Anybody who's ever worked in a fucking McDonald's is, or even in a mid-grade kitchen of a family restaurant, I would rather suck dick for 3 hours a day for the same money as working an 8-hour shift in a fucking kitchen.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and some of us wouldn't, and that's fine too. But the other thing is that when feminists say this, I was speaking to Hyper Chicken, who told me about statistics in Australia. I doubt that it's different in Western nations, and I'm not completely sure if these are correct, but they sound pretty accurate to me. Most clients of sex workers, and I'm not talking about street kids, which I'll get into in a bit, most clients of sex workers are disabled.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially what feminists are doing is they're stigmatizing people, not just men, but people who want to be able to have human intimacy and have to pay for it.
People with cerebral palsy or whatever. Or
this is a case in Australia because it's legalized in Australia. It's taxed and everything, so anyone can go to a sex worker. So most of the people who do are guys who can't have sex or have never... unable to, find a partner for whatever reason. And this is evidently what happens if you decriminalize prostitution. It doesn't turn the place into a debaucherous hellhole. It gives disabled people something uplifting to do. that's what feminists don't want.
Yeah, and it's like this is essentially criminalizing prostitution is not only bad for prostitutes and bad for the people, it's also bad for disabled individuals who want to be able to have access to human intimacy. And can't necessarily do that because they are disabled. So yeah, thanks feminism, you fucking assholes.
Yeah, it's really nice. It's really nice.
Really nice of you
to think about the humanity of these, that guy in a wheelchair.
And yeah, you're right. Absolutely.
Who never gets touched other than by his home care worker to evacuate his bowels for him.
Yeah,
that must be a very nice life, right?
Yeah, and the other thing is that. When you look, for example, they did studies, and this is the only study I know of street kids and who was exploiting them sexually. And this is a situation where you're not like a woman, a 25, 30-year-old woman saying, hey, I can work minimum wage or even work an office job, but I'd rather actually just have sex. I'd rather do that and make money. That's not a situation. Street kids are actually in the situation of exchanging their sexuality for food.
For survival.
when you look at those kids, half of them are male. So this isn't a female thing, Megan. This isn't a female issue. And of the kids who are sexually exploited, at least from the survey, and it's a British nurses survey, 50% of them are exploited by women. Now, 70% are exploited by men, and I guess the remainder are exploited by both. But it's still significant. There is a significant number of women who are exploiting street kids, and these are really the kids, the people who are exchanging sex for survival. And, of course, you don't hear about that in Megan's little worldview, because it's not about helping anyone. It's about pushing an agenda, and that agenda is seeing women as victims.
Well, seeing men as perpetrators, right? So that's how that works.
Continual.
What was the after she started talking about the sex thing, the blowjob thing? What was the like her other points just briefly in this particular point?
Nobody is entitled to sex. Granted.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
Your fetish for Asian women? That's not a fetish.
No, it's a preference. Well, it can be a fetish. But most often it's just a preference.
Yeah, that's actually, I think, dehumanizing Asian women. Schoolgirl porn. So what? Women like their god-awful, like schoolboy yaoi.
Yeah, and women like their firemen posters and, you know, and calendars
anal.
And stuff.
There's lots of women like anal. Or calling women whores while you pull their hair. That's pretty...
Or choke them. That's the one thing that I don't like about not having long hair, is there's nothing to pull.
These are just people's sexual preferences. As long as it's not against someone's will, keep the fuck out of their lives.
Yeah, I know. I love this whole thing. Like, you have feminists all the time. When you call them totalitarian and authoritarian and stuff like that, they're like, we're nothing like that, blah, blah, blah. But they want to dictate how people have sex. Like, they literally, like, everything that they've been doing for the last God knows how long, right, with this, the yes means yes law and the, you know, reversing the burden of proof and all of this other, and the affirmative consent, and you have to ask permission at every stage in order to know that she's consenting. And, you know, I keep telling guys who are like, yeah, no, it's like... they want men to beg for sex, and I'm like, just turn it around and make her beg, make her convince you, tell her to get out her pom-poms, because and really make it convincing, because otherwise you just won't know if she's affirmatively, enthusiastically consenting, right? Oh, can I film it, right? And you'll probably get booted out the door, right? And the screams of outrage will be heard in orbit, but you'll be making a point about the stupidity of this bullshit, right? They want to dictate, like, to... the most minuscule degree, right? Exactly how sex happens between people that they've never met and will never meet, right? But they have a right to tell us how to have sex.
You know what? Let's shake it up a bit, Mike. For point eight, are we losing you?
No. What's up? What about point eight?
Shake it up.
Let's shake it up. Why don't you switch the genders and call it meninists? Meninists do not hate men's naked bodies. Go. Let's see how it sounds.
Meninists. Oh, sorry. Number eight. Understanding that objectification and nudity are not the same thing. Meninists do not hate men's naked bodies. We love men's bodies. We have them. We use them every day for things like eating and walking and snuggling with puppies. We'd love it if those bodies belonged to us for our own use and enjoyment rather than to the female population. Our bodies don't exist to be admired or sexualized or fucked. They exist for us to live in. Our culture has melded sex and sexuality to such an extent that we think they are one and the same, but they are not. Objectification can feel sexy because we've learned to sexualize objectification. we've learned to perform sexuality rather than to feel it. The reason why male nudity is so fraught is not because menists are afraid of their own skin, but because male nudity is not allowed to exist without being pornified. This is why people freak the fuck out when men breastfeed in public.
Sorry, I really got you into that trap.
I was going to think, dick feed in public? Is that a thing?
Pee in public. Go urinate in public.
Because we think the only reason a dick should be out is so that women can ogle it. There we go. Stop turning our bodies into jack-off material. Flick-off material, I suppose. And maybe society's prudish will fall away.
Oh, God.
Okay. See, when women's bodies are naked, they're sexualized, right? Frequently, if they're attractive. When men's bodies are naked, they're, like, criminalized, right? It's like a woman walking naked down the street is just, you know, guys will be, like, looking and, oh, you know, looking her up and that's hot, right? Guy walks naked down the street, he's going to get himself arrested. There's going to be women who are scared of him, right? He's going to be seen as a threat, and he's probably going to end up on the sex offender registry.
Yeah. I mean, there's a little bit of a difference there. Can you see it? Feminist Megan, can you see that? Just a smidge of a difference. Women are sexualized, men are criminalized when they're naked.
Well, they're both sexualized. They both face the default state of being sexualized, but when men are sexualized, it's bad, and when women are sexualized, it's good. That's why women have it worse.
I know. Women are allowed to be sexual on their own terms, and that's like an oppression, and men are considered dangerous if they use their sexuality in any way that's even a little bit deviating from what's considered okay. Right, like pulling hair and pounding a woman up the ass and calling her a whore because she likes that. But that's not okay for him to do that, even if she wants him to. He's demeaning her, even though she won't want to fuck him anymore if he doesn't do it.
Well, how about this? How about, okay, so why don't we do what Megan wants us to do? Let's not sexualize female nudity and not criminalize male nudity.
Excellent.
Yeah. And then women could just be sort of like, I don't know. You know, watch Rick and Morty? Those creatures that come out of the box whenever they want to have something done?
Oh, right.
Mr. Mises.
Yeah.
That women could be like Mr. Mises. Absolutely no sexuality there. Just complete null.
Excellent. I think that would be an excellent thing. And I think, honestly, with some of the backlash that we're seeing right now over MGTOW and sort of the marriage strike and all of that has to do with women like really not being happy with, you know, the idea that like men just might not be that into them.
Yep.
So maybe we should up the heat a bit, or actually turn the thermostat down a little more.
Mm. And, fish might not need bicycles, but you know, when fish don't get their bicycles, they seem to get rather uppity. All the good bicycles gone?
Where have they gone? Oh, dear. All right.
It's really interesting that she says she loves women's bodies and they hate men and men's sexuality and sexuality with men. It's an interesting dichotomy she's setting up here.
Well, she's clearly a lesbian, and not just because she loves women, but also because she hates men. I mean, her entire attitude toward the naturalness of women hating men and hating sex, right? It's a natural thing, given all of the trauma that men have inflicted on us with their sexuality over the centuries. Blah, blah. Like, this woman probably has some kind of wacky history of unpleasantness with some man somewhere. I mean, a lot of loopy second wavers do. She's just projected all of that. It's not just natural for her with her trauma to hate sex and hate men. It's all women. All women have the right, and it should be seen as perfectly natural to hate sex and hate men because some men have raped some women or something, right? It's she's projecting it's like the collectivist thing that you project your damage onto everybody else, and you just assume that everybody else in society works the same way you do, and it's like highly solipsistic and yeah,
go away. The thing is that why should we have more terms for how male sexuality hurts us than how it is actually beneficial?
Like, well, because that's the feminist way to be.
No, that's not the feminist way to be. They just inherited this ridiculous stricture from, I think, Christian mythology and probably manipulated it and turned it into something even worse than it was then. This idea that women are made impure by the touch of a man. It's not a fucking feminist thought. If feminists are nothing if not completely unoriginal. Okay, do you want to do the final one?
Final point.
All right. Number 9. For the love of God, stop trying to make feminism cool.
Okay, I'll stop.
Okay, stop me there.
Yeah, it was good. Well, we all agree on this.
Okay, shall I carry on? All right.
Yes.
Popularizing feminism doesn't work. Not because I don't think feminism should be popular, but because in order to sell it to today's masses, it needs to be watered down to the point that it loses all meaning. See the original listicle. We don't need to sell out. We shouldn't have to sell out. We can keep our values and still bring women on board. If people don't want to get on board with actual feminism because they don't like actual feminism, maybe they need a little more time to think. Or maybe they're just not feminists. I'm all for educating people, but let's educate them right. Making feminism sexy and digestible for people who don't think patriarchy is a problem isn't going to help feminism. Being a feminist doesn't mean you can't be cool and fun or even attractive, but actual feminism isn't about being cool and fun and attractive. It's just not really that cool or fun or attractive. Sorry, not sorry. I mean, what we're fighting are things like domestic abuse, rape, sexual slavery, incest, pedophilia, and femicide. It's not cool and fun and sexy. That's not the point. Feminism is not a fucking fashion trend. Can I read the bit at the bottom? Megan Murphy, founder and editor of Feminist Current, is a freelance writer and journalist. She completed a master's degree in the Department of Gender, Sexuality and Women's Studies at Simon Fraser University in 2012 and lives in Vancouver, BC with her dog.
All right.
That's her blurb.
Okay. First of all, I don't think feminism should be popular. So how do you expect to create change if not to convince people? Or because this is starting to sound really fucking sinister, Megan. Like, you don't think you have to actually convince people. People are beneath you. They're unwashed masses, right? You don't actually have to appeal to their logic or their reason or their self-interest. So how are you going to affect this change? Well,
she's gonna lobby for it and write it into law and, you know, and stuff like that, right?
Or, I would be remiss if I ever wrote something. Like, if I wrote something like this about men's rights activism, I hope someone would take me out and shoot me. Because the only way that I see this happening, if it ever does, these changes, is if people recognize that they need to change, that this is something that is right. Not right, morally good, but also something that can benefit everyone.
Change comes from the ground up. Like, you know, like you didn't have you didn't have the VAWA and then awareness campaigns about domestic violence. No, you had the awareness campaigns about domestic violence and all of the picketing and all of, you know, the postering and all of those things, right? And then you had the legal change that was wanted by feminists who were doing all of that, right, trying to draw attention to it. You have to draw attention to the problem and you have to get the public on board before you are able to make meaningful change within the actual system. It's the same thing with gay marriage, right? It's not like some court decided that, oh my goodness, you know, this whole thing is just really unconstitutional back in 1950. It was just as unconstitutional in 1950 as it is today to treat gays the way that we treated them, right? But you had to get the public on board. You had to get a significant amount, at least 40% of the public that feels very, very passionately about treating gays in a reasonable, humane, human way, right? And giving them the rights that they deserve. You have to get people on board with that, right? Abolition didn't happen until there was public support for it, even though, you know, there were people in government who really wanted it, you know, wanted to do away with slavery. They couldn't get it done without public support. That's how a movement makes change. That's how it's done. Cultural change happens on the ground and seeps its way up.
Yep. Well, I have to say, for what I would like to say about this entire list, is this is, in some way, this is good. I'm glad she had a verified, like, she has a position.
Yeah, no, she does. I mean, it's contradictory at times, but...
She has a position. Like, she's saying this is what feminism is. Not that feminism is everything and anything and the molecules in the spaces between the molecules. You know, it's like she's saying what feminism is. I mean, it's appalling, and I'm really glad that she wants it to be unsexy, uncool, and unfun, because I like the idea that she's going to isolate herself more and more, and when people sort of grow up and realize that self-righteousness isn't actually more fun than a nice hot cup of tea, they will start moving away from what she's selling, and she will isolate herself more and more. I like that. She's taking a stand, and she has no intention of selling her stand to anyone. Good. Enjoy your... Enjoy your island that you're going to create out of this attitude. But thank you, because this is feminism. These are the feminists who do things.
Yeah, this is the radical. And every time somebody says radical, they're using that word wrong. Right? Radical does not mean on the fringes. Radical means at the root. It's essentially... fundamentalist Christians are the ones who are doing the Bible right. They're doing Christianity right. Everybody else is some varying degree of pick and chooser.
Which is fine. I mean,
I agree, it's fine. It's fine to be a pick and chooser. Just don't call, you know, the people who are actually doing the religion properly, don't act as if they're crazy or they don't represent the religion. They're the only ones who are accurately representing the tenets of the religion.
Well, okay, I'm gonna probably piss everyone off and say this. If you look at the Bible in terms of a wisdom tradition that was trying to maintain order in very difficult times,
it's not bad.
Picking and choosing is sensible.
Yep.
Because picking and choosing is saying, okay, what part of this actually makes my life easier? Makes it easier for me to deal with the people around me, makes it easier for our communities to survive.
What's applicable now in modernity that what might not have been applicable 2,000 years ago?
So I think you could argue whether or not a completely authentic one-to-one representation of the Bible really is authentic to what it was. But you're right, it's authentic to what it says, but is it authentic to what it's trying to be?
Supposed to be, yeah.
And I say that because we do have, I don't know if you want to call them theists, whatever, religious people, people with spirituality, spiritual faiths in our audience. And, like, in my opinion, every way that we've structured, every tradition has its own wisdom. It doesn't have its wisdom in different contexts, though. Like, the Muslim context doesn't work in the States or in Western cultures. And to be quite frank, if you want to live in a place of security and peace, you abide by the fucking rules that created security and peace.
Yeah.
That means you learn to live in a secular society.
Yeah, agreed. And I don't want people to get mad at me like as if I'm dissing religion, because I'm not. I actually think that religion offers, including Islam, offers a lot of useful things as far as just having a center around which to gather your community, right? Yeah, and actually, Jonathan Haidt did a wonderful Boyarsky lecture on this a while ago, and anybody should go and watch that. He was also one of the co-writers of that article in Time, I believe it was, called The Coddling of the American Mind, which was also excellent. Essentially, religion gives us all kinds of really awesome things. It gives us some bad things, just like political ideologies sometimes give us good things and sometimes give us bad things. And just like the unique propensity of human males to cooperate with each other is what gives us the internet, and it's what also gives us some really bad atrocities throughout history, right? That's just how it is.
Mike has gotten quiet, so I think we're probably...
I'm just listening to you guys while I try to think of something to say. Religious books are a bit like the Highway Code. There's like a little pamphlet that tells you what the rules of how to drive, which is quite handy when you've got sort of a road system, and particularly when it's young, and you know, not everyone obeys every part of the highway code at the same time. It's slightly sort of moralistic. And 2,000 years from now, when we're all sort of driving little Jetsons-type space vehicles all around the place, we don't have to look at the highway code in the year 2000 and say, look, we still have to live our life like this.
Yeah.
Not only are the books fluid in their interpretation, the evolution of such books is also fluid.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. But in terms of feminism, I don't know what the fuck it makes easier.
Well, yeah, no, but my point was that you can't say that these radicals are fringe. These radicals are the ones who are, they're the ones who are doing feminism properly. They're the ones, you can say that they're radical, because you're right, they are radical. They are the basis. They are the foundation of feminism, and everybody else is just kind of way over here, right? It's the moderates who are on the fringes.
Yeah. No, I would agree. Like, the radical feminists are the ones who truly believe what feminist theory is implying. Because if you say patriarchy is the most important oppression through which to look at the history of humanity, that patriarchy is the worst oppression. Because otherwise, it makes no sense to call it a patriarchy if it's not the worst oppression. Better off calling it a classiarchy or whatever.
Oligarchy, or, yeah.
Yeah. If you're going to say that, then you have just implicated men as being sociopaths. And I don't see how a political movement is going to change men's opinions of women if they
haven't been able to be moved to human emotion at any point in the past.
Yeah, how is feminism going to do a damn thing if men haven't, you know, woken up and said, hey, I shouldn't do this to my wife, I shouldn't do this to my mother, I shouldn't do this to my sister.
Is
a strident big red yelling on the corner going to suddenly make women wake up and be like, oh, wow, I mean, my loving relationship with my wife, the fact that I care about deeply about my daughter's success, the fact that I care about my sister and my mother, that has not made me wake up to the trials and travails and my desire to help women.
Difficulties, yeah, the difficulties that women go through.
Oh, none of that, but Big Red screaming at me on a corner.
She has done it.
Thank you, Chloe.
She's seen the error of my ways.
Opened my eyes.
I'm going to dig out this Y chromosome from my skin.
Okay, what do you think? Should we call it? Call it
I got to go have a cigarette. I am, like, so jonesing for one. And I think it might not even be raining out there.
Yeah, let me just. I don't know how much more we can say about this. You want to look at some of the comments, see if there's anything worth a poke at down there.
I
imagine that it's horrifying. Yes.
Are they in support of her? I'm sure.
Yes. All of them.
Probably. Yeah, no, I'm pretty sure that there were lots of negative comments, but they were all snagged in the moderation queue.
Of course, because criticism is good.
Criticism, I know, and dissent and challenging.
Thinking critically is good.
Yeah, no, all of that
but
is good.
She said it in her thing. In her thing.
Yeah.
Criticism is good.
Dissent is good, yeah.
Not really. I love how feminists always, and once again, we come to the end and we come to the same conclusion. Feminists say one thing and then they immediately back off from it. Well, why don't you just be honest about what you're saying and just own it?
Yeah.
Anyway, if you enjoyed this, if you enjoyed us dissecting this feminist theory, and do consider, like, if you enjoyed this show, if you enjoyed the format, which, if you are a Canadian, you probably sort of get our style, because you've listened to Trailer Park Boys or Bob and Doug McKenzie. So you sort of get where we're coming for. We just sort of, like, it's a Canadian thing. You know, we got long winters. We got to sit back, kick back, put our feet up, talk about basically, like, bullshit for hours on end just to while the time away. Yeah, it's beauty. It's beauty.
Beauty.
So, beauty, eh? Yeah, that's our style. That's our style. But if you enjoy this, which is sort of like that, except we also talk about things that are sensible and political and cognizant and maybe interesting as well occasionally.
And we drink a lot.
Yeah, we drink. Well, you guys drink a lot.
I don't today. Damn it.
Yeah, Karen will be drinking a lot as soon as the camera is on.
As I get home. I don't have anything here. It's an office.
Anyway, if you enjoyed this, please do consider becoming our patron. www.patreon.com/honeybadgerradio. And thank you for listening. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for enjoying our work. And also, thank you for hating it, for those of you who tune in because you absolutely hate us. We love you,
and
too.
And thanks for the mail, guys. It really keeps us going. So
yeah, it helps us realize why we do this. Okay.
Yeah.
Night.
Toodle pip, and Godspeed.
Beauty.